I'd ask you to stand with me if you're physically able to Revelations chapter 4. We'll look for a few minutes at a throne. Revelations chapter 4. If you're able to stand, do so for the reading of your word. Verse 1. John, the apostle John the beloved, he said this: "After this I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet, talking with me, which said, Come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. And immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one that sat on the throne. And he that sat on was to look upon like a jasper and a sardine stone. And there was a rainbow round about the throne in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats, and upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices, and there were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal. And in the midst of the throne and round about the throne were 4 beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, and the second beast like a calf, and the third beast had the face as of a man, and the fourth beast like a flying eagle. And the 4 beasts had each of them 6 wings about him, and they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever, the 24 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne, and worshipped him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created." Father, I ask you to bless the reading of your word. God, I confess to you, without you I can do nothing. And Lord, I pray tonight, God, that you would give unction unto this man. And Lord, to your people, you would give the word of God. And Lord, help us to be able to make the proclamation. And Father, help us to do it in the right spirit. And help us to do it, God, and for the right purpose. God, you know every heart that's amongst us here. You know every person. You know every inner and outer and every molecule of our being. And we ask you, Lord, to search us tonight. As the brother prayed the other night and preached, search me, O God, and see if they be any wicked way. Try me and see, Lord. And we ask you tonight, Lord, to search us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen. You can be seated. I want to preach to you about the throne of God and the voice from heaven. There's a lot of people that are wanting to hear a voice from God. I witnessed to a man not too long ago, and he said, if God would just say something to me, he said, I would believe. Isn't that amazing? Come on, God. Perform for me. God ain't going to do that. He that created all things. The Bible said in 1 Corinthians 1 that God chose the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. But there's going to be a voice before too long, and they're going to hear from heaven. But I don't think they're going to like what they hear. You see, right now, God is speaking to the world by His Word and through the Holy Ghost of God. The Holy Spirit of God is pricking man's heart and showing them through the Word of God. There's the Word of God going out on the airwaves. They're going out through paper tracks. They're going out over the internet. It's going out in the airwaves. It's going out through cable. It's going out from mouth to mouth and from person to person. God is getting the message out there. Yes. The Bible said that they're sowing the precious seed. He tells us in 1 Peter 1 and 23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the word of God. What did he say in Romans 10, 17? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. God is speaking from his throne through his word, and by his word, from his word, and through the Holy Spirit of God. Let me tell you what you can do. You can throw the tracks down. You can shut the TVs off. You can change the channel on the radio, But you can't stop the Spirit's fingering in your heart. You can't stop the truth of the Spirit of God that deals with you on a personal basis. And that's exactly what I entrust the Lord to do. Amen. That's how I got saved. Amen. The preacher had preached. I'd heard preaching before. People had testified. I heard testifying before. I'd pretty much wall them. I'd pretty much shut them off. I'd pretty much say, well, it's fine for you. That's okay for preaching, but it's not for me. No thanks. And I trusted that there was a God somewhere. And I thought, you know I'm a sinner, but... But until the day that the Holy Ghost showed me my condition and He showed me where I was going. And He showed me there wasn't nothing I could do to improve it but one thing. And it wasn't to straighten up, it wasn't to be good, and it wasn't to do better. But it was to believe on Him and to call on Him that is able to call the things that are not as though they are and they become. And that's exactly what I did. The preacher preached, if you're lost here and the Lord shows you your lost condition, if He bids you come to an altar and receive Him. And that's what I did. Amen. Listen, there's going to be a time here in the near future, I think, that the voice is going to sound. And when it sounds, man, you're talking about people going to be freaking out and running. But it's going to be too late. The Bible said that you can send away your day of grace. There's going to come a time when grace, that mercy is going to rejoice. There's going to come a time that mercy will rejoice at the judgment of God, for there'll be no more mercy and there'll be no more grace shown. The Bible said, after this, I looked and behold, a door was open in heaven. And the voice... And the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither. Now, a lot of folks say that's figuratively, and it's not a literal voice, but I just believe when God said repent, He meant to turn from your sins and turn unto Him. Amen. When God said believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved, I just believe that He meant what He said. He said what He meant. Here, God said a door was open in heaven, and there was a voice that came out of heaven which said, come up hither. And I'm listening for a voice. And that's not the only place that He tells us there's a voice likened to a trumpet. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 13, He said, but I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, do you believe that? Do you believe that Jesus Christ suffered a beating like no man had ever suffered, and that they pierced Him on the cross, and they pierced His side, and out come blood and water, and He literally died? He did not swoon. He didn't just fall into a coma. He died. He gave up the ghost. There was no blood pumping through His body. And friend, they laid Him and they buried Him in a borrowed tomb. Oh, that grave thought it had Him. Satan began to rejoice because he thought he had destroyed the plan of God, but all he was doing was fulfilling the plan that God had already had from the foundation of the world. You see, God had already planned to give His only begotten Son. God had already, in His foreknowledge and His planning, had already laid down how He was going to do it. You know, when God does something, it's totally not what we think. I think about Naaman the leper whenever he was coming to grab the mighty man of valor, whenever that he came to the prophet Elijah and was wanting to be healed. He thought he'd come smack his hands, do an incantation or something, and that he would be healed. But it wasn't like that. He didn't even come and see him. He sent a servant and said, go dip 7 times in Jordan. Well, anyhow, I thought it ought to go. And that's the way a lot of people treat God. If God don't do it like they think, they say, well, I'm just not going to believe. Well, you have that right not to believe. Amen. For those that's watching by the way of internet, you have that right. And pretty much you're going to choose this day whom you will serve. Amen. Those that have heard the gospel of salvation and has rejected the mercy of God, friend, you'll live with the consequences. But it's not the will of God. You know what the will of God is? He tells us in John 3:16 that He loved you so much that He paid for all sin. Not just part of the sin, but all sin. 2 Peter 3:9, He says, "It's the Lord's longsuffering to us. We're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." We know what the will of God is because it's in His Word, and He's told us what His will is. Amen. But there's going to be a voice happen, and it's going to be literal. And praise God, it's not going to be like a thief in the night to the believer, because we are to watch and look and hasten to the coming of our great God and Savior. That's what he tells us in Titus chapter 2. He said, looking for that blessed hope, or chapter 3, amen. Looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior. We are to be looking for the Lord to come back. And I guarantee you, if you've been born again, there was a time you started looking. You may not be looking now, but you used to. You may not be witnessing now, but you used to. You may not be praying now, but you used to. You may not be witnessing now, but you used to. You may not be worshiping now, but there was a time when you couldn't wait. There was a time that you could bring anything to God, because you know God can do anything for you. The only thing God can't do for me is fail. The Bible said that we love him, and that, listen, that if we didn't stay faithful, he cannot deny himself. He loves you, church, amen. The Bible tells us that he which hath begun a good work in you shall perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. Amen. The Bible tells us, he said, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. There's a false doctrine going around that if you die, you lay in the grave till Jesus comes. No, no. The Bible's clear on that. He says to be absent from the body is for a Christian. To be absent for a saved man, for one who has called upon the name of the Lord and knows him, and God knows him and he knows God, for him to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible said this. He said, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, even them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord. It's not by the word of a man. It's not by opinion of a church. It's from the throne of God. He said, for this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. What kind of a shout? A voice like a trumpet. You say it's a trumpet. No, it's not a trumpet. It's a voice of God saying, come up here. But it's going to sound like a trumpet. If you read in the Old Testament, when some of the saints of God and the prophets of God stood, it said it sounded like many waters. I don't know if you've ever been to the ocean or not, but when you get down at the ocean, it can be quiet as a mouse everywhere else, but that ocean, buddy, is coming in making noise, amen? Let me tell you, that can't hold a candle to what God's fixing to trump out. When he says, come up hither, there's going to be a vacancy on this earth, amen? People are worried about this place being overpopulated, and there may not be as many going as what a lot of people think, but all the redeemed are going when he calls, amen? The Bible tells us this. He said, Therefore having this seal, he said, the foundation in 2 Timothy 2:19. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. That's like a living sacrifice. God tells us to be a living sacrifice. I beseech you therefore, brethren, Romans 12, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Somebody tell me what the problem with the living sacrifice is. Crawls off the altar. Amen. Let me tell you what you can do. You can place it back. Amen. You can place the altar back. You can get back to the altar. Amen. I've had to crawl there before. There's been times that I've had to literally crawl before the throne room of God. But I know I'm invited, for he tells us in Hebrews 4:16, therefore let us boldly come into the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. God promised that he would hear your prayer. He said his ears are open unto his saints, and their cries he will hear. Amen. He goes on to tell us here in 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4 and verse 16. He said, will them with God bring with him? Verse 17, for this we say, 15, for this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. It's comfort to me to know that this is temporary. Yes. It's comfort to know that my retirement is not here.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to be here till he calls me home, and then I'm going to my new home.
Amen.
Never going to move again. That man, it'll be my last move that I'm going to make. Amen. You say, well, preacher, are you confined there? No, friend. You're going to rule and reign with Christ. We'll see here in just a few minutes if the Holy Spirit gives me liberty. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse number 51, these things. He said, behold, I show you a mystery.
Yeah.
See, this was hidden to the saints of old. And this is only revealed through the Apostle Paul.
Yeah.
Amen. The rapture of the church, it's still a mystery to some people.
Yeah.
Well, you got folk in their eschatology, they don't believe in the rapture. They believe that you're going off until the tribulation happens. Some don't even believe in the tribulation. They say that's all figuratively and God didn't mean what he said and he didn't say what he meant. It's just typology, and that came through the Catholicism of the Roman Catholic Church. That's where those teachings come in. Amen. And those that changed the Word of God and those that brought a lot of the modern versions that we have, a lot of those, they practice witchcraft. Amen. They practiced the arts and craft of witchcraft. Many of them, I mean, they dabbled in everything. They didn't believe that this book that I hold in my hand is the Word of God.
Amen.
I believe it to be true. I even believe the cover, which says Holy Bible.
Amen.
Amen. I believe it's true through and through. Why? I got saved from the information in this book. By receiving what it said and by acting upon calling on the Lord, I got born again. This is a road map unto my life, how to be able to live. I may not line up all the time, but praise God, where I err, the Spirit of God through the Word of God corrects me.
Yes, it does.
Amen.
Amen.
So the rapture of the church, or the catching away, rapture's not in the Bible, but the word Bible's not in the Bible either. But you have one, don't you? It's the word is rapio. It means to be caught up, a catching away. And that's the church is going to happen. Well, I just don't believe that. It don't matter. It's going to happen anyway.
Amen.
Amen. Just because I don't believe something don't mean it ain't so. Some people don't believe God heals, but I've been healed.
Amen.
Some people don't believe that God still delivers, but I've been delivered.
Amen.
Amen. God is able to do exceedingly. The Lord Jesus Christ is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all. How much? Above all. Oh, I think he'll forgive you of this, but he won't. He'll forgive you above all.
Amen.
You can think. Amen. I mean, the Lord is a merciful God and he's almighty.
Yes.
And he's still able. What he did then, he's able to do now.
Yes.
Amen. The power that you had with God, you can have even more.
Amen.
All you got to do is just believe it and act upon it.
Yes.
Amen. I was praying, and I think I told this at the church. It may be of another place I preached, but I had been praying and told this preacher that we anointed a sister with oil, and she said she didn't obey the Lord when he told her to come and be anointed. I didn't say who it was, but she was hurting. And later she said, Lord, you get me get back, I'll come and I will ask the church to anoint me and pray the prayer of faith. Amen. Amen. And she prayed the prayer of faith and she said, you know, I feel better. I feel better now that I've done that. And I've had that happen many times.
Yes.
To where people would not just say, well, I just don't believe. I'm not a healer. I can't heal myself. I couldn't save myself.
Amen.
But my Savior can do all of that and more.
Amen.
I couldn't deliver myself. Do you know the Bible said, Paul said this, he said, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and give himself for me. Do you know Paul didn't crucify himself? Before you get mad at me, you can't crucify your own self. You got a free hand. Amen, amen, amen. You say, well, how do you do that, preacher? You got to yield to God wholly and ask him to put you in the crucified life. You got to yield. Amen. Sometimes I live a crucified life. Sometimes I live about 1 foot shy of that. Sometimes I live a crucified life, a sanctified life. Sometimes I have to battle with that.
Yeah.
But I am what I am by the grace of God. Amen. I had my mother-in-law told me, she said, Michael, she said, you're a mess. And I said, I may be a mess, but I'm his mess.
Amen.
Amen. And I tell you what, I know whom I have believed, and I know whose I am. I am. I'm in the hands of the Lord. Amen. I'm in competent hands. But the rapture is going to happen. You say, when, preacher? No man knows the day or the hour. Let me ask you, if it happened tonight, how would it be with you? Would you make heaven? Before you answer that, let me ask you this. Why do you think you'd make heaven? That's it. You know what most of us do? Most of us check and said, am I living close enough? And I believe in living right. I'm not talking about not, you ought to do right. It's never right to do wrong. But I'm not trusting in living right to be able to get there. If I want to stay in fellowship with God and have my prayers answered and not have the hide beat off of me, I want to live right. Amen. Hebrews 12 covers that, and he said he chasteneth every son whom he receives. Amen. He said, if we were without chastisement, then were we bastards, illegitimate, and not sons. Immediately after the rapture of the church, after they hear the sound, these two things going to happen, and they're simultaneously at the same time. At the rapture of the church is going to be the judgment seat of Christ, and it's in the heavens. And there's going to begin on earth the tribulation period. And the Bible, a lot of folks say, well, tribulation period already happened. Others will say tribulation period is figuratively. Well, Jesus said it'll be a time on earth such as has never been to this time. He spoke about it as in something that's going to take place. He didn't say like unto and as it were or if it could be. He said there's going to be a time of weeping and wailing. Such a time that has never been known. We've seen some hard times on earth. There were time of the black plague and bubonic fever and all the plagues that swept through Europe and killed off, I mean, thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people. Measles, chicken pox, when they had no vaccine. Right now we got vaccinations for those things. It's not a big deal, but there's been many untold folk die when it would sweep through a nation. But that don't even hold a candle to what God has said this was. The judgment seat of Christ is not for the world, it's for the Christian.
Amen.
The judgment seat of Christ has nothing to do with whether you make it or don't make it. It has to do with the capacity you're serving God in. It has to do with how you've lived your life. You know, a lot of folks think they can live any old how and get by. You don't get by with nothing with God. Amen. And let me tell you, God has judged my sin at Calvary, but my works do follow. You can read it in the Old Testament. You can read it in the New Testament. You can read it in the book of Revelation, the last revelation that was given. Your works follow you. Even the lost people's works follow them. We'll discuss that. I'll try not to keep you too long. But the judgment seat of Christ in Romans chapter 14, in verse number 10, he says this. This is for the church, for the redeemed, those twice born. He said, 14 and 10, he said, but why dost thou judge thy brother? Well, because it's easier in judging me. That's the answer. You know why you judge your brother? Because you don't want to judge yourself. It's easy for me to look at you and say your clothes are raggedy, or you're not got your hair combed right, or you're not doing something, whatever. It's easy to see somebody's weakness. And so the Spirit of God said this. He said, why dost thou judge thy brother? Why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. He's talking to the church of Rome, Christians. He said, for it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then every one of us shall give an account of himself to God. Let us not therefore judge one another any more, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. Don't try to tear nobody down because you can. There's people weak in the faith you could tear down. There's people that's watching you that your inconsistency can tear them down. There's people that looking to you, amen, as an example that we could tear them down. And I say we, I include myself especially. He tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse number 10, still on the judgment seat of Christ, he said, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone, talking to the church of Corinth, the Christians, he said, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone, preachers, deacons, Sunday school teachers, from the pulpit to the back, everyone will give an account of themselves before God. I had somebody tell me one time, I'll meet you at the judgment seat. And I said, honey, if you make it to the judgment seat, the only body's hide you're going to be concerned with is your own.
That's right.
Amen. He said, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body. What are you going to give account for? You're going to give account for the things you did in your body. According to that which you have done, whether it be good or whether it be bad. That, listen, you say, well, I'm lucky, preacher. I'm the once saved, always saved. When God makes you a child, you are a child, but that don't give you a license to sin. It don't give me a license to sin. Let me help you. I have sinned since I've been saved. Let me help you even more. So have you. Now, my sin may not be your sin, but we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Amen? There's sins of omission, something you can do, disobedience, and commission. Omission's failing to do what you know is right. He that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is
sin.
What God said. Then there's sins of commission. You can cross the line and take part in a thing that you know is wrong. And I'd venture to say that everybody in this room has done that as well. If you're a child, the Holy Ghost probably warned you before you did it. And if it happened so fast like a flare of the temper, He warned you immediately afterwards and drew you to repentance.
Yes.
I'm not talking about heaven and hell. I'm talking about standing before God and giving account of your stewardship as His child. In case you want a little closer look at that, turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul writing to the church of Corinth, talking to Christians again. Let's look at verse 9. He said, for we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry, ye are God's building, according to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder. I have laid the foundation, and another built thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay that is laid than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. If you're not in Christ, you're none of His. The Bible said in Romans, I think 8 and 9, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of His. What does it take? It takes the Spirit of Christ. Amen? It takes the Spirit of Christ. Christ in you, the hope of glory. He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son of God hath not life. Don't care if you're a Baptist, Church of God, Pentecostal, Pentecostal Holiness Deliverance Four Square. I don't care what tag you stick on yourself. You better have the Son. Amen. Amen. You can be Free Will Baptist, Southern Baptist, Sideways Baptist. You can be, it don't matter. He that hath Son hath life. He that have not the Son of God. Church membership, doing good, keeping the commandments. You can keep them all day long, friend. But if you've ever broke one of them, you're guilty of all. Amen. He said this. He said, now if any man build upon this foundation, verse 12 of 1 Corinthians 3. Now if any man build upon the foundation of Jesus Christ, if any man build upon this foundation gold, that's a pure metal, silver, precious metal, but not as pure, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble. Every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, what's to be burned? The man's work. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him, who? The man, the temple, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. Let no man deceive himself. If any man among you seem to be wise in this world, let him become a fool that he may be wise. I don't know if I read verse 11, 2 Corinthians 5. He said this, therefore, chapter 5, verse 11 of 2 Corinthians 5. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord. The terror? Most Christians I run into are not afraid to live loosely. They're not afraid to let their hair down and say and do just about anything. And they got an attitude all 1 John 1, 9 it. Worldly sorrow worketh death. Godly sorrow worketh repentance unto salvation. There's a difference between worldly sorrow and godly sorrow. Godly sorrow will have some works behind it. You sorrow unto repentance from the heart. Worldly sorrow, you just sorry you got caught. There's a big difference in the two. Worldly sorrow will say, well, I'll do better. You get a case of the do betters. I'm going to do better. I'm not going to cuss no more, and I'm not going to lie no more, and I'm going to go to church. I'm going to read my Bible, and I'm going to tell somebody about Jesus, and I'm going to do better. No, you got to come to God like you are guilty and confess it to Him and ask Him to forgive you of this and ask Him to cleanse you of it and ask Him to deliver you from it. It doesn't matter if it's me or you or who it is. It's the same pathway we all must tread. Knowing, therefore, the terror of the Lord. Let me tell you something. You're going to stand before Him one day. I'm going to stand before my Savior who bled and died for me and took a beating in my behalf. And I'm going to tell Him when it's asked, why'd you do that? He said to Peter, James, and John, could you not watch with me for an hour? Boy, we can say something about them, can't we? Man, Judas forsook him. Peter denied him. Wow. And we live like we live, and we can't read our Bibles, and we can't witness, and we can't come in here with joy unspeakable, full of glory, because we can't live in that way. The only way we can is when we're right with Him, and it's an inward thing. It affects your outward life, because if inward's right, the outward follows suit. If my inside man is right, my outside man conforms. Amen. But if your inside man is wrong, your outside man conforms. He said, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That's the difference. He said, therefore, knowing, therefore, the terror of the Lord, we persuade man. You don't hear much terror anymore. Now you got it. Why, you're a happy-go Christian now. You're going to give an account one day.
Yes.
I just 1 John 1:9. Listen, that'll help you in fellowship, but you still got a record you're going to give an account for. God will forgive you and take you back. Let me tell you something. I had some kinfolk that I helped, that I loved them, and I went out on a limb for them, and I helped them, and they took and squandered everything that I had labored and worked for and tried to help them with, and they just squandered it away. And they asked me to forgive them, and I did. But there's a record of it. Amen. Now I know as far as my sins being cast as far as the east is the west, my sins are covered. But my stewardship, I'm going to give an account of. You'll give an account. A lot of folks don't want to even think about it because they don't know the terror of the Lord. They don't want to think about having to face up and pull up and give an account of themselves to God. Roger White wrote a song, I Find No Fault in Him. The second verse of that song, he said, one day before Jesus I must stand and I know. And then I will then be judged for my life here below. And as they search the books for the things that I have done, God the Father will say unto His Son, I find no fault in Him. Amen. You say, well, how is that? Because there is the judgment seat of Christ.
Amen.
No matter what's there, you are one of His. Count is settled, it's square. But you'll still give an account of it to God.
Yes.
Therefore, knowing the terror of the Lord, your mama can't stand for you, your sister, your husband, your wife, your kids. You're going to stand before you and your Savior and give an account. Knowing the terror. Listen, we've all wronged somebody somewhere. I've wronged my family, my dad before. I've wronged my mother before. And I had to come to them, and when I got caught at it, and you always get caught, be sure your sins will find you out. And you have to answer to them. And my mom said, honey, why? Why would you do that? I can't tell you the hurt. Because the answer wasn't anything. It didn't satisfy me. I knew it wouldn't satisfy them. You're going to give an account to God for the things you've done. And it's not going to be pleasant. I hear people talking, man, I want to go to the judgment seat. Man, I'm not happy about that part. Afterwards, it's going to be great, the marriage supper of the Lamb. But He said, every man's work shall be tried. And you say, well, preacher, I just don't believe that. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Where is it? Verse 30. Let me go verse 28. He said, but let a man examine himself, and so let him eat that bread and drink of that cup. He's talking about the Lord's Supper. But it don't just apply to the Lord's Supper. It applies to following God. It applies to being in the will of God. It applies being prayed up. It applies about obeying the commands of God. He said, let a man examine himself, and so let him eat that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. That's part talking about it. He said, for this cause many are sick and weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. You see, God takes care of us in two ways, three ways. One, our sins are covered by the blood atonement. Two, Galatians 6 and 7 said, "Be not deceived, God's not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap." And here, he also says it as well, that God will chastise you. In Hebrews chapter 12, he tells you God will deal with you as children. He'll chasten you. He'll scourge you. But then there is the judgment seat of Christ where you're given a reckoning for it. Have to answer to Him. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, here's what he said. "Every man's work shall be manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward." You know, there's a lot of preachers, and I guess the greatest thing I hate is the hypocrisy that's in my life. Y'all look at me surprised. You have hypocrisy in your life. If we just own up to the hypocrisy. I am what I am by the grace of God, but I know I'm saved, and God knows I love Him. But there's times that we do things mechanically and our heart ain't in it. There's times professional religionists, we know ways to get around things and to bypass our responsibility and to do it half-heartedly and not to do it for the glory of God. That's hypocrisy. Or maybe we can look down at somebody who's less gifted than what we are and consider ourselves a aged wisdom saint. The Bible says when a man thinks himself to be something, when he is nothing, he deceiveth his own self. There's all kinds of hypocrisies that we judge. You ought to do like me. Amen. What I'm saying, church, if you will be honest with God, with where you are, don't try to be accepted by the church, trying to worry what they think. It's not. It don't matter. So what if somebody receives you or don't receive you? The one that matters is if it's right with Jesus. That's the one that matters. That's the only one that matters. If you get it right with Him, everybody else can take it. Amen. Amen. He said, every man's work. I've heard some people say that they're going to... I don't know, and I can't by revelation say exactly how the judgment seat of Christ is going. But I can tell you, I had in my mind this picture up until recently. I had in my mind that the church would come before the Lord, and as a blast of God's presence, it would go... The fire of God, the Bible said our God is a consuming fire. And the presence of God, just consume it. And whatever was left, you get to cast at His feet. Some are going to cast ashes. But I believe that God will judge us individually, simultaneously, at the same time, and collectively, and individually, and deal with each one in a personal way, one-on-one. He's big enough to do that.
God.
That's right, sister. I can't prove that by the Bible. But until you show me something else, that's what I believe. According to what I've seen from the Scripture. And that's what I base what I believe on. I've had people tell me, well, I don't believe that. Well, that don't make me not believe it. God said it. I'm going to believe it. The Bible said, be filled with the Spirit. And people say, well, I don't believe you're filled. Well, I want to be filled. Amen. Amen. Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be ye filled with the Spirit. That's not smorgasbord, take it or leave it. That's a command from God.
Amen.
He expects that of His people.
Yes.
Would you expect anything less of your child than to represent you properly? Your kid's out cussing and gallivanting around and behaving himself. You wouldn't stand for that. And guess what? Neither will the father.
Amen.
At the same time on earth, immediately after the rapture, starts tribulation. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. I'm not going to keep us long. We've just come out of a revival, and I know that everybody's tired in their body, but I believe that this is worth staying for just a minute. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, in verse 1, he said, "Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or troubled, or be troubled, neither by spirit nor by word nor by letter as from us, that the day of Christ is at hand." Someone is saying that the day of God's wrath was at hand, and they'd been taught, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and 16, that the Lord himself shall come and with a shout and the voice of the archangel and call us out. They had been taught that God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by the Lord. That he hadn't appointed us to wrath, and that the church would escape this, and they troubled about it. Because they were being persecuted for their faith, they were being beheaded, they were being killed, they were being hunted down like animals. And when you're going through, during the World War II, people, when Hitler was destroying the Jews, many of them thought, this is a tribulation. Time of Jacob's troubles come. I mean, they were being put in camps and burned alive and made lampstands out of and skinned alive and had things, put them on instruments and ornaments, gassed them, starved them, did experiments on them. He was a vile, hellish man. Had the spirit of Antichrist. Well, the Thessalonians had the same kind of stuff going on in their life for the persecution of their faith.
Sounds like I talked about me, so I ain't going back to church. Now my big toe hurts and I ain't going to church and I'm tired.
Yeah, you really suffered for the faith, brother. Hallelujah. But these folks were losing their life over it. They were laying down their life. They put themselves in jeopardy for the cause of the faith. Many men are doing that today all around the world. If you read about ISIS killing folk, not because they've did anything other than believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You say, well, preacher, they are this denomination. It don't matter. They're born again. They're dying for Jesus Christ. I believe they know him. You ain't going to die for somebody you don't know. There was a letter going around in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 16 and 17, 18. He said, "But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness, and their word will eat as doth a cancer. Of whom Hymenaeus and Philetus, who concerning the truth have erred, saying the resurrection is past already." You see, that was the things they were saying here. There was a letter going around, or somebody seen the letter, or they heard about a letter that said the Lord had done come back and you're in the tribulation. And they had them tore up, and Paul said, don't be worried about that. Day of the Lord isn't going to happen unless there come a falling away first. What falling away? We're seeing it going on now, the falling away. But it don't just limit it to that. There's going to come a falling away that the church is going to be separated out of here. And that's the first coming. And that's what we read about in Revelations chapter 4.
Yeah.
But simultaneously, as the judgment seat of Christ is going on in glory, the tribulation is going on here. And the Bible said this. He said, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day, the day of the Lord, shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition." The Antichrist has to be revealed before the Lord comes back with the saints. Revelations chapter 19. The Antichrist has, he said, "Who opposes and exalteth himself above all that is called God, that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. He said, remember you not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Now you know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. What's withholding him? The mystery of iniquity doth already work, only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. Then shall the wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. That's Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 down. When the Lord comes back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, that's when he's going to destroy the Antichrist. I'm trying to hurry. He goes on to say that this is during the tribulation period. He said, Now then shall the wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved. For this cause, what cause? Because they rejected it, because they wouldn't receive the truth. For this cause shall God send them strong delusion, that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. But we are bound to give thanks to God always for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief in the truth. When you receive the gospel of your salvation, amen. That's so what he tells us. In Matthew 25, if you want to read about the great tribulation, read it. I'm not going to read it for sake of time. But Revelation chapter 19 and verse number 11. Matthew chapter 25 verse 3. Read it. Write that down. Read it when you get home. About the abomination of desolation, where the Antichrist sits upon the throne of David and declares that he is God and commands everybody to worship him. Revelation chapter 6. He tells about the tribulation and about the mark of the beast, that he makes everybody, oh, I wouldn't take no mark. If you can't be saved in the day of grace, you won't be saved during the tribulation. I talked to a preacher, and he's got out of fellowship, and he thinks he's lost, and I don't know if he's ever been saved. He's still God's. He said, I believe God's leaving me here to go through the great tribulation so I can point people the way. I said, man, you can't even live in the age of grace. You wanting to go through that? Not me, buddy. He's had 3 heart attacks and lost everything he has. And I said, man, I thought I was a tough somebody, but you're a lot tougher than me. He was laying on his back looking up in the hospital. And I said, you won't live very much longer? And he said, yeah. I said, I believe I get things fixed up.
Yeah,
really. I'm going to. And he did a couple of times and just fell. It matters what you believe. If you think you got to keep yourself, you're going to be a miserable Christian.
Right.
Everything you do is going to have an alternative motive. I got to stay right. I got to do this. I want to do right because he made me right. He forgave me. Revelation 19 and 11, he says this, and I'll close. I'll read more than 11, but he said, and I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness do he judge and make war, and his eyes were as a flaming fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Do I need to tell you his other name? If you want to know what it is, John 4, 1 and 14 tells you who it is. And the Word become flesh, and we beheld His glory. The glory is the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. Amen. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible said the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. Let me help you out here a little bit. There's nothing like the Word of God to interpret the Word of God.
Amen.
I talked to one preacher and I said, see, the armies is the church that's with the Lord. He said, no, that's the angels. And he went to Matthew chapter 25, I think, and he said, wheresoever the carcass is, he sent the angels out and they gathered them together. I said, yeah, but they're not gathering the church. The church is in glory when that's going on. And I said, well, who does the Bible say the armies in heaven are? Because they do. It does say. Go back up to Revelation chapter 19, verse 8. Hold verse 8. Look at verse 14. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. Verse 8, same chapter, same subject, same speaker. And to her was granted. Who is her? The bride. And unto her was granted. Who is the bride? The church. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints.
Amen.
Nothing like the Bible to interpret the Bible.
Amen.
I showed him that and you only said, that's your opinion of it. I didn't think I injected my opinion in it. I was told when I got saved, I was told a lot of stuff that wasn't true. By people that was told a lot of stuff wasn't true, they didn't study it out. They figured Uncle Bob or Joe Bill or whoever it is or Pastor Sam or whoever, they thought they're a man of God and they couldn't tell you something wrong. But let me tell you something. Anybody can tell something wrong. There's been a time or two I've given scripture and gave the wrong book. Now, I didn't do it on purpose, but I did it. If I accidentally kill somebody, I'd still be put in jail for it. It wouldn't be first degree murder, but it'd still be against the law. Amen? Manslaughter. Unless they were breaking in my house, then it'd be self-defense. But he tells us that when the Lord comes back, he's going to come back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he's going to judge the nations. You see, here's what the amazing thing to me is that God forgives the saints, but he's going to judge their works. God is going to send all the wicked in Revelation chapter 20 and verse number 11, he says, I saw a great white throne. This is at the end of the millennium. He said, and I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, for there was no place found for them. And I saw the dead, small and great. This is not the church. This is those that have the wicked that are in hell right now. And all those that die and go to hell. And all those that are alive when he comes back and that dies. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. Even those that are going to hell are going to be judged according to their works. You better have the terror of the Lord, man. Works matter. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead that were in them, and they were judged, every man according to their works. Well, preacher, I thought if you wasn't saved, you go to hell. You do. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire, and whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Yeah, but they're judged according to their works. Now, I can't understand what the lowest hell is different from the highest part of hell, but there's degrees.
Yes, there is.
And because I don't understand it or can't fathom it or get my heart and mind and soul around it, God's Word declares it so, and praise God, a just balance and a just weight will be meted out. We think people that's killed some of our loved ones and murdered the saints and done these things that they got away. They ain't got away. Titus chapter 3. I'm done. I got to close. Titus chapter 3, verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly and righteously and godly in this present world. Your attitude, your hope, is to be looking for that blessed hope and glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who